Morning.
So we had a good time this morning. A few comments reminded me of something. Lived in Memphis, Tennessee for a while. And in that, was part of a preaching praise type team that would go into local prisons, federal and state, and we would conduct services. And it was run by a lady who was Pentecostal from that background, I'm a Baptist. But I was one of their primary preachers, and then it one service, I was there and I was preaching, and I mean, I was really just, going at it. And of course, wearing a suit. As I preached there, the jacket come off, then the tie, buttoned down a few things, had the handkerchief, and it was going. Sleeves rolled up, I was preaching, doing all that stuff, and really had a good time with the Lord, I thought. And then after the service, that lady comes to me, and I just thought it was funny, and she goes, "You know, Brother Jim, you almost got loose." Almost? I mean, what is she used to? Because I thought I was loose. But I just say in all this, let's have a church and let's get loose. Because we're going to talk about the church this morning. And we're going to talk about the growing church. And we're going to look at some of the characteristics and principles of what it takes to grow a church. You know, there's been a lot said in church life about how to grow a church. And my opinion, a lot of it is just simply marketing. Now, I'm okay with marketing, but there's more to it. I mean, we should be salesmen for Christ. We should be the best salesman that we can be. But it's more to it than just simply selling. So how do you grow a church? In a moment, we're going to take a look at a church that's in the book of Mark. Now, when you think about that, the scientists, archaeologists, they think they have actually found this spot. So they were going there, and they were digging, and they were doing all these things. And, of course, when they took the dirt away and excavated, there was a wall like that. And then as they dug and did a little more, all these things that archaeologists do, I'm not sure what all they do, but they dug a little more, and then you go a little further out, there's another wall, like an outer wall. And then they dug a little more, and went further out, and there was another wall, an outer wall. So that leads me to believe that this was a growing church. Actually, they think this would have been Peter's house, or maybe his mother-in-law's house. It was a church that was in the family. And so there you look at this early church, and you could say, like we would say, that they were in a building program. They were growing and expanding because of the people who would come. And that's really what we want to look at this morning. I mean, based on this example, what does it take to grow a church, to have a growing church? So if you want to have your Bibles or just follow along, we're in Mark, the second chapter, and I'll read the first through the 12th verse. So before we get there, now Jesus, he had been out teaching and preaching and healing and doing all these things, and then we come to chapter 2 here, and the Bible says, "And again he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately many gathered together, so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door. And he preached the word to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. When they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven you.' And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?' But immediately, when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, 'Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven you," or to say, "Arise, take up your bed and walk"? But that you may know the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins.' He said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house.' Immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all. So they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, 'We never saw anything like this.'" So first of all, what I want you to see here in the scripture is the crowded church. In those first couple verses there, we see that Jesus had gone to Capernaum, and the word got out that they heard that Jesus was there preaching. It would be like us saying that there was this great meeting or revival. And first of all, why was it crowded? Why were the people there? Well, I don't know about you, but a lot of ways I'm tired of going to church and nothing happened. Going to church and the church service is dead. So when the folks went there, they went there and it was crowded. Why was the church crowded? Because the word got out. The people understood in the community that Jesus was in the house. Jesus was in the church. You see, when the word gets out in this community, that folks can come to this church and feel the presence of Jesus, feel the Holy Spirit, this can be a crowded church. Amen. Now, I know that Jesus is no longer with us physically, but we are his body, are we not? People can come to church and feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. They can feel God working through the members of the church. That's what people want. That's what they need. They want to go to church and feel the presence of Jesus. Why was it crowded? The Savior was there. The Savior was there. And what was Jesus doing? I just found it interesting. Of all the things that Jesus could have been doing in the church, what was he doing? Now, when I say all this, I'm not opposed to programs in the church. Just hear me. I'm not opposed to programs. But you see, you can have programs and yet not have any power. You can have programs in the church and not have any power in the church whatsoever. Just people go and they almost become a distraction for what's going on in important things. I mean, I'm Baptist, and so I come from that Baptist life. In the Baptist church, we got programs for everything. You want to play softball, basketball, it doesn't matter. We got a program. If you like to play tiddlywinks, and I don't even know what that is, but we got a program for that. We got programs for programs. You just go and sign up, and we'll get you locked into a program. And I'm not against that. But what was Jesus doing? Of all the things we do in the church, Jesus was there preaching the word of God. The Bible says that he preached unto them. The most important thing that should happen in the church is the pulpit ministry, the preaching and teaching of God's word. Amen. So we got to realize and understand it's not my opinion, the preacher's, the congregation's opinion. It is God's opinion about things that should be important. It's what God says that should rule in the church. He preached the word unto them. You want to see people changed, transformed in the church? Then preach the word of God in the church. It's through the preaching of the word of God that people are changed and made more like the Lord Jesus. You can do all these things, but we need to preach the word. You want a crowded church here? Let the word get out that you can come here and feel the presence of God and have the scriptures preached to you. People will come. They will come to church because it's not happening a lot out there. That is the heart cry of this nation, of this world. There's a lack of preaching of the word of God. Amen. What we need is for the man of God to stand behind the pulpit of God and to preach the word of God to God's people so that there might be change. It needs to be primary in what we do, the preaching of the word of God. Do you want a crowded church? The word needs to get out that Jesus is there. You feel his presence. The word needs to get out that the word of God is preached there. The lives can be changed. The people will come for that. But here's an interesting thing about gimmicks and marketing. If you use gimmicks and games to get people in church, you got to use gimmicks and games to keep them there. People need to come, feel the presence of Jesus, have the word preached to them. That's where change will come in the church and in this world. We're the salt, we're the light, all those things. The crowded church. The Savior was there, and the scriptures were there. Now I want you to see the concerned companions. I'll say even the concerned Christians. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And they could not come near him because of the crowd. They uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. Now, what I want to do now, I just want to use my sanctified imagination, if you will. I'm going to tell this story and kind of put it in our language for understanding, okay? Sanctified imagination. So these four guys, they knew this guy that was paralyzed. And we'll just call him Old Joe. I don't know what his name was. And you know, they understood and they heard that Jesus was in town and there was a great crowd. And they were just thinking, you know, if we could just get him to Jesus, then maybe that would change his life. Just get Joe to Jesus, that would change. Change his life. But how are we going to do that? So they go and they think about it and say, well, we'll go to his house. You know, they go up there and they knock on the door. His wife answers and they talk to her and say, hey, we want to get Joe to church. She thinks about it. Well, how are you going to do all that? We don't know. We're still thinking about it. And she says, that church, it's a good church. So not too long ago, somebody came from that church and gave me a book. You know how people always want to give you books. And I got nothing against books. Read all you can. But it's one thing for someone to give you a book. It's another thing to have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's the book we should be concerned about. He said, not only that, the pastor came and visited me. That's good, right? Pastor out visiting folks. But it's one thing to know the pastor of the church. But it's another thing far better to know the master of the universe. See, those are the main things. And so they talk a little bit. And they how do we get Joe who's paralyzed through this church? And so they sit there and they think about it a little bit. And finally one of the guys says, you know, I served as a medic in the Roman Legion. This is how we're going to do it. We're going to make a field litter. And we're going to put him on there and we're going to carry him. So all the guys thought that was good and they put it together. You know how it is. You got to have one. If you got four guys, you put them at each side here, right? And you got to work together. I'm sure nothing changed, right? Get down. Ready to lift. Lift. They picked him up, and they moved out. Now, when you first think about that, well, that's not much. That's not too hard. Friends, let me tell you, someone who was, when I was enlisted, was a medic, carrying someone on the litter is hard work. You don't know how much he weighed, he's heavy, he can't move, he can't help, and now you got him on this litter, and you're trying to take him to a church. You're taking him over hard terrain. I'm sure it was hot. It's always hot in the Middle East, so it doesn't matter. It was hot. And so they carried him there, right? And they're working together, and they're going and they're moving. What I'm saying, church, there's times when we have to work hard to get someone to Jesus. We got to work hard. We got to be willing to sweat. We got to be willing to do what it takes to get someone to Jesus. They didn't give up. They had an idea. And also notice this, right? They had to work together, all four of them together. Sometimes, church, we got to work together to bring someone to Jesus. You know, you may go and witness to them. Nothing happens. Someone else goes. You make a group. You keep going. You keep going. You keep doing it to witness and to bring them to Jesus. Well, how long do they come to Jesus? That's my answer. You don't quit. You don't give up. These four guys, they didn't do that. I mean, they were willing to work together. I mean, they're taking him to see Jesus over tough terrain. It's hot. We don't know how far it was, right? 100 yards? A few miles? But I guarantee you, it was hard work the whole way. Bringing people to Jesus can be hard work. See, sometimes the church nowadays, we want to shy away from that. We don't want to get involved. We don't want to get our hands dirty. We don't want to work and labor. These guys did because they had compassion. Because they knew in their mind and their heart, if they could just get Joe to Jesus, then perhaps there would be change in his life. They knew that and they were willing to do that. Do we have that type of compassion about the people that we know and that we work with? Well, these guys did. So they go and they're working and they're bringing Joe to Jesus and they come up to the church. And we already talked about what? The church is crowded, right? No room, even at the door, the Bible says. So all the folks are standing there listening to Jesus. You know, and here they come. I'm sure they're going up there like, hey, excuse me, trying to get to Jesus. Excuse me, I have this paralyzed guy trying to get to Jesus, right? But it's crowded. And you know how the good church folks are, right? They're all standing up there going, this is where I stand. I stand here every Sunday. Why should I move? Right? Trying to get to Jesus, right? That's my spot. And so they're working that. So what do? Do they give up? I mean, are they through? Are they finished? I mean, we put him on a litter, we brought him here, but folks won't get out of the way, so we're just through. We're going to quit. No, church, they don't quit. They sit there and they think and they come up with a creative solution.
How are we going to get Job to Jesus? One of them thinks and looks at the situation and goes, you know, if we can get him on the roof, maybe we can lure him down to Jesus. And they sit there and look, and the ladders on the outside, the stairs are often like this, and then this, and there was a flat roof. The other Gospels tell us that they actually dug down because the roof often was mud and grass and that sort of thing, so you could literally dig through it. So here they go. We're going to get Job to the roof. Now, if you can imagine that. So they go, and they talk about it. They probably tell Job, well, I'm going to strap you down. So I'm going to strap you down. Don't worry. We're going to get you to Jesus. He was probably worried. So they go, and they pick him up once again. Now, if you think just carrying someone on a relatively flat ground is hard, try to navigate some stairs with somebody on a litter. Right? Hard. Hard work. I'm telling you. So they go, and they work him up one side, and they work him up the other side, and they set him down on the roof. And then they dig through the roof. Hard work to bring people to Jesus. I'll just ask you, church, how hard are you working to bring somebody to Jesus? So the scene's going to shift. You got the guys on the roof. Now we're going into the service. And the service there, Jesus is there, and he's preaching and teaching, and the people are listening. And as if you were there in that service, you would have seen a little light start to go in the ceiling, and it would have gotten a little bigger and a little bigger. And you start to see these particles come down. Of course, you know how the good church folks are, right? Because in church, you can't look around, right? Even though you want to. You're like, what is all this stuff that's coming down, all this light that starts going there? And the hole gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And then finally, there in front of them all, this guy on the litter falls right in front of them. Jesus is not concerned. He's still preaching and teaching. Now, I like what Jesus says. It says, when Jesus saw their faith, whose faith? Did you catch the church? When Jesus saw their faith, the faith of the four, not the guy laying on the mat, saw their faith. Jesus was impressed by their faith, their willingness to work hard to bring someone to him. My prayer for us all that Jesus would look at us and see our faith. And to bless our faith that we're willing to work to bring someone to Jesus. To see our faith. Jesus was impressed by the four's faith. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven you. I was saved when I was 12. I wasn't really involved in the church. Didn't have a youth program. So programs are important. So there was another church in town that had a strong youth program. I was in the local high school in PE, physical education, in ninth grade. There was a guy named Chris who was a 10th grader, and we had PE together. All right, so PE basically consists of doing a few push-ups and playing basketball for an hour, which we were all good with that. But when I started there, Chris, you know, almost every day, here we go, like, look, you want to come to church with me? You want to go to this youth thing with me? And I would politely say, no, I don't want to go. I'm not interested. Because I was away from the Lord. Day two. You want to go to church with me? You want to go to youth with me? And I would say no. And he wasn't rude. He wasn't crude. He was none of that stuff. He wasn't over the top. But he would just simply ask me if I wanted to go to church. Well, after several months, right, you know what he did? He just kind of like beat me down. Right? And so I'm like, yes, I'll go. I'll go. I'll go to church with you. So I go to church with Chris. And my parents wouldn't carry me to church, and I couldn't drive, so his parents would go out of their way 6 miles and pick me up and carry me to church. Which he also knows what that means, right? They had to carry me back home. So 12 miles. And they did this for almost a year. Sunday morning, Sunday night. Youth stuff. A lot of youth stuff, right? And they would go and they would do that. Through that process, through a youth camp, I was called into the ministry, and I started preaching. You know, if I do anything for the Lord, or what I've done for the Lord, a lot of it will go back to Chris. Right? Because Chris was willing to talk to me and ask me, try to get me to church. God saw, what? Chris's faith in my life, and honored that.
So now whenever I preach, a lot of that goes back to Chris would ask and wanted me to come to church. And his family took care of me, groomed me in the church. See, my prayer for all of us is that God can look at us and see our faith and honor it in someone else's life. Now, our personal faith is important, but as a body, Jesus was impressed by their faith. So we saw the crowded church. Jesus was there. The scriptures were being preached. We saw the concerned companions. I mean, they were compassionate. Right? They had to cooperate. They had to be creative. They had to bring someone to Jesus. Jesus saw their faith. Now I want you to see the conquering Christ. Now when I say all that, sometimes we go, well, we're church folks. We know Christ and conquering church. I want you to grab hold of that fact. I want you to understand and know that the Christ that we serve is conqueror. He is God. We serve an all-powerful and almighty God. There's no problem too big, too small that he can't solve. And yet we don't hold on to that. He was the conquering Christ. You see in the story here, some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. See, the most important thing is to have your sins forgiven. Now, I don't know what the four were thinking. Maybe they said, hey, we brought this guy on this litter all the way here. And all Jesus could say is, your sins are forgiven. See, Jesus understood. The most important thing that can happen to anyone is that they are to be saved. That their sins are forgiven. Jesus could have simply healed him physically, and he still could have walked upright into a devil's hell. Jesus wanted to give total healing. Sins are forgiven. And he's physically healed, as we'll see here in a moment. Because he's all-powerful. We serve an all-powerful God. He's the creator God. If you think about the terms that galaxies actually dripped from his fingertips when he created the world. I don't know about you, but that's power. That is the God we serve. Church, have you read the end of the book? We win! We act like we don't win! We win! And yet we'll go through trials and tribulations in the moment, that's true. But we serve a Christ who conquered sin and death. That is the Lord we serve. That's the head of the church. We need to hold on to that and believe that and let that anchor our faith. Some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Now the scribes, they're interesting to me. They kind of remind me of folks in the church, and you'll see them every now and then. They usually kind of sit up close, and they sit there and they go like this, and they go, bless me if you can. Come on, preacher. Bless me if you can. I've heard that sermon before. I've heard that song, bless me if you can. See, they're coming to church even with the wrong attitude, right? They're coming there to pick and to see what's wrong and to be negative instead of seeing the actual miracle of God. That these four men loved this guy so much that they would go and drag him there and bring him down through a roof and put him before Jesus. And that Jesus would say, your sins are forgiven. They didn't think about that. They just said, this guy is saying blasphemies. Jesus goes on. But immediately, when Jesus perceived in the spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? See, the God we serve not only is all-powerful, but he knows everything. The Bible says he immediately perceived what was in their hearts. Now think about that. That means the God we serve, he knows what we're thinking. He knows what we're thinking even before we think it. Have you ever thought about that? That is the God we love. He knows everything about us. And here's the interesting thing. When he looks at us, he can see our deepest needs and desires. But the other side of that, he looks down and sees the real person, right? He sees us in our darkness and in our sin. But here's the good news. In seeing all that, God loves us. God wants to forgive us of our sins, knowing us for who we are. That's good news, folks. I understand if someone loves me when I put up my best effort. But when someone loves me when they see the real me, that's a different story. He loves us all that way. He's the God we love. He wants to forgive us. He's the conquering Christ. So Jesus, as he talks to him, he said, what's easier to say to the paralytic? Your sins are forgiven and arise, take up your bed and walk. What's he saying?
He's saying, look, if your God, that's what he's going to demonstrate to him, if your God, it's just as easy to say, your sins are forgiven, arise, get up and walk. Why? Because I'm God. That's what he's saying to him. You ask him what's easy? Both are just as easy if you're God. You ever notice the scribes and the Pharisees and sometimes the disciples, when Jesus was talking to them, it was kind of like this? High flyer, right? He's saying to them, look, I can forgive sins. I can tell this guy to get him walking one. Because I'm God. I'm going to demonstrate it to you here in just a moment. That is the God we serve, the conquering Christ. It says immediately, when Jesus perceived in the spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? What is it easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven you? Or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know, in other words, I'm going to demonstrate, but that you may know the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. He's like, I'm going to demonstrate this to you. I'm going to show this to you. I'm going to tell him to rise, get up, take your bed, and go to your house. So when you look at a growing church and what it takes, you got to understand that a church will be crowded if people will feel that Jesus is there. People will come when the scriptures preach there. People will come when the people are concerned enough to bring other people to Jesus and work hard to do that, cooperate together. Be creative in the ways that they bring. You understand that a church will be crowded when the church has to grasp hold of the fact that we serve a conquering Christ. He's all powerful, knows all things. He can forgive sins and tell somebody to get up and walk. I want you to see the captivated congregation. Verse 12. Immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all. So they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. Never saw anything like this. Do you see why this is important to be a model for the church? The folks went there and they saw something amazing, and they glorified God because of it. I mean, my prayer for this church, that when you have a church service, that maybe somewhere way in the back, when something happens over here, they'll jump up and go, whoa, glory to God. I was amazed that I come to church today. See, when we leave, though, we don't leave that way, do we? But we should. Church should be a celebration, a time when we come, not like the scribes, but we should expect that God would move in the church, that lives would be changed and transformed, that people would be saved. Church would be crowded if we had these expectations. They were amazed. Amazed. And they glorified God because of it. And when they left, we never saw anything like this. Now, I don't know if churches would go with that, but it is scriptural, right? Because it's in the Bible. Maybe our parting thing should be, we never saw anything like this when we have a church service. So my prayer for you is that the church would be crowded. It would be crowded because people would come here and feel the presence of God. People would come here because the scripture has been preached. People would come here because they know that you've worked hard to bring someone to Christ, and God has honored your faith to bring them to Christ. They would understand that the people of this church understand that Christ, hey, he's the conqueror. They read the end of the book. They know that we win. And when you go to church, they want to be amazed. They want to glorify God. And when they leave, they say, we never saw anything like this.